Okay, so it is the it's 3:30. Welcome everybody. Good afternoon. Welcome to Plenary 2, which is nothing about us without us, challenging ableism in research careers. I'm Jan Schwillera. I'm one of the trustees of Crack Vitae. I'm very pleased to be able to moderate the panel this afternoon. The Plenary brings together speakers from a range of perspectives on disability, on the issues facing disabled researchers, and on what needs to change. We know that disability matters in all aspects of research careers. We can see this in the data around funding, recruitment progression, as well as the lived experience of disabled researchers and discrimination in workplaces. Listening to the challenges faced by disabled researchers in this plenary will not and shouldn't be a comfortable experience. We invite you, we encourage you to use the plenary to consider what you can do and what you will do to challenge ableism. So introduce our speakers before we begin. Our first speaker will be Professor Kate Seng. Kate Seng is a Professor of Gender and Employment Studies at Edinburgh Business School, Heriot Watt University. Kate's research explores gender and disability in employment with a particular focus on co-designing interventions to improve the working lives of those who have experienced considerable disadvantage and discrimination. Recently, Kate's research has centred on the needs of neurodivergent scientists, women and trans people experiencing problematic menstruation and disability in science careers. In addition, Kate is a member of the Cross-Party Working Group on Women's Health in the Scottish Parliament and is on the UCU Scotland Executive as Equality Officer. Our second speaker this afternoon is Dr. Hamid Haroon. Dr. Haroon works as a research scientist in quantobiomedical magnetic resonance imaging, MRI, at the University of Manchester, where he gained his PhD in 2005. He helped to establish the university's disabled staff network in 2007 and became its first chair. In 2015, he went on to launch the National Association of Disabled Staff Networks, a super network that connects and represents disabled staff networks in universities and colleges, in NHS, trusts and other sectors, which he currently chairs. Hamid won the university's Staff Volunteer of the Year Award in 2019 for being a tireless campaigner and has been highlighted by the Royal Society for his work as a disabled scientist. He's much in demand, as you might expect, as a scientist, speaker and activist, and has even featured in a new children's book called Superhero Scientists. Our third speaker is Rachel Van Crimpen. Rachel is Director of Equality, Diversity, Inclusion and People in the Faculty of Science at the University of Nottingham and manager of the Nottingham BBSRC Doctoral Training Partnership. She's led on postgraduate research, recruitment and support, including the QAA-funded Postgrad Researchers from Diverse Backgrounds, a framework for defining, measuring and supporting success in 2023, which she'll be talking about today. Rachel also leads the development and delivery of the University of Nottingham's Faculty of Science EDI Action Plan, which includes a range of work to support inclusive recruitment and career progression and leadership of a work package focused on neurodiversity support and awareness. This is your amazing panel this afternoon. I'm now going to hand over to Kate.
Thank you very much, everybody. I'll just share my screen. So you should be able to see a presentation that says Challenging Ableism in Universities. As Jan said, my name is Kate Seng, and I'm based at Heriot Watt University on the Edinburgh campus. And I'm going to talk to you today about our research, which has examined the experiences of disabled academics going back to 2017. So we've got about 6 years worth of data. My presentation is a provocation. I warn you in advance that there's not many cheery stories in researching disabled people's working lives in universities, but hopefully we can find a good way forward. So I want to acknowledge our wider research team, which is quite significant. Our work has been funded by the EPSRC for disability inclusive science careers. We've been funded by NERC, and we're currently at the moment, I'm principal investigator of the EDI caucus funded by UCRI with support of the British Academy, and disability inclusion is a major theme of the work that we're doing. So just a little bit of background, this is probably very familiar for you, but universities are an interesting site to do disability research because you have two constituencies. You have students for whom the university has a statutory responsibility to preempt the needs of disabled students, whereas for staff, they have no such statutory requirements. So people report falling off a cliff edge. They do their degree, their master's, their PhD, then they move into a postdoc or a lectureship and all the disability support they had falls away. We also know that alongside this, there's stubborn gender inequalities across disciplines. And this is intersectional zone. We see the very low numbers of Black female professors in the UK. We know there's very low disclosure rates. So HESA data hovers just below 5%, usually. Universities themselves will generally report about 1% to 2%. But if we look at the whole population, it's around between 15 to 20% of the population are disabled. So either universities are not employing disabled people or people are not telling universities that they are disabled. It's probably a mixture of the two. And in particular, we see that disabled people are othered in senior positions in universities. So that's not to say that disabled people aren't there. They're quite often hidden and maybe don't disclose their impairments. And we orientate ourselves around the social model of disability. So we don't focus on tailoring or changing the individual to fit ableist working practices. We want to change ableist working practices to be less ableist and to meet the needs of everybody working in universities. So we don't see disability as something that resides in the individual. So for example, we wouldn't say a person with a disability, I'm a disabled person, I'm disabled by society. I'm not disabled by my impairment. That's not to neglect impairment effects such as pain and fatigue, but disability itself, we see it as a form of oppression. And that's really helpful from the perspective of trying to develop changes to working environments, because we focus on the barriers to inclusion rather than focusing on changing the person to fit damaging working environments. So we've been researching this for a while. From 2017, we've been funded by UCRI, I've been funded also by the Royal Society of Chemistry to look at how to make laboratories more accessible. And we've undertaken a variety of work looking at disability from different lenses. So we've looked at neurodiversity, recognising that not neurodivergent people consider themselves to be disabled. We've done work looking at problematic menstruation and gynecological health conditions, which under the Equality Act could be considered disability. And we've been funded by a variety of organisations. And I think it's clear that the funders are getting more interested in how do we support disabled people. What we're not seeing is a parallel interest from universities on how to support, employ and progress disabled people. So I won't go through all of these in detail. One of the activities we did as part of our disability inclusive science careers was we evaluated the policies of every Scottish university around disability. And with the exception of one university, every single disability policy was orientated towards managing the disabled person out of the organisation. So it's disciplinary capability, and everything was around reducing absence. So unlike other protected characteristics, disability is fundamentally positioned as a negative, a lack of performance, rather than seeing disability as a form of diversity. We see the performance management systems in university causing particular problems with people overworking themselves, perhaps taking annual leave to catch up on work or going to conferences and the need to take time off, but not reporting it to the university as disability leave. We also see researchers saying you can't be a disabled academic. So disabled people themselves saying you can't be a disabled academic because they don't see the leadership in universities, and they just see that the idea of an ideal academic is very rigid. And I'm going to show you a slide of what the ideal academic is. I apologise in advance if there's any HR practitioners in the audience, but I have never interviewed a disabled academic who has wanted to contact HR. And the extent of that is that when we've undertaken focus groups in person, people would not be interviewed anywhere near the HR department because they were worried they'd be seen speaking to us. The distrust of HR is extremely strong, and not without good reason as well. So I apologise. I know there's lots of lovely people working in HR, but unfortunately, in our research, that's not come through. And we also see disciplinary differences. So the sciences, for example, so we see EPSRC is way ahead of other funders in terms of disability. You can include EDI funding in your future leadership application, for example. So there are disciplinary differences, some of that to do with funding. But we also see, for example, humanities scholars saying, well, I've gone down the paper writing route because I can't write a whole book, but then their career is stymied for not writing a monograph. So there's quite a lot of disciplinary differences. And it might depend on the kind of research that you're doing as well. So for example, if you're laboratory based or you're doing field work, those are very different experiences to being a management scholar, more kind of office based. And we see a lot of shame and stigma, particularly around the body. So for example, if the body leaks in the workplace, whether that's urine, blood, feces, a great deal of embarrassment, a great deal of shame, and people spending a lot of their time, a lot of additional labor managing their bodies to hide it from the people they work with. So when I started giving these talks, I used to try and say all of this without taking a breath. I cannot do that anymore. Going across all of our studies, we have a look at what is the ideal academic. So this isn't, we're not talking about the kind of things that might be written, you know, in a role descriptor. What are the things that an academic, a researcher needs to be able to do? Now, the truth is nobody can do all of these things, but it's the norm that structures the way other people think an academic should be. So I'm not going to try and read them all out, but we can see there's lots of conflict. No one works 24/7, for example, but there's a belief you have to be able to work 24/7. Being able to go from one topic to another without a break, whether that's lecturing, meetings, doesn't have any issue with walking from one building to another, for example, enjoys networking. I guess some people enjoy networking. I've never enjoyed networking, but it's something that's seen as a really important part of an academic career. But we also see that the ideal academic is disembodied. So they don't get pregnant, they don't give birth, they don't have miscarriages, they don't have IBS, they don't have any condition or any life event that makes their body more visible to the people they work with. So this is a challenge. So from our perspective, we want to move away from models that change people to fit discriminatory work practices. So we see a lot in the gender equality work that we train women to negotiate really hard for a pay rise. We know they still won't be as successful. So we need to train the people, we need to train research leaders and people who design jobs, write proposals to embed disability into the work that they do. So our focus needs to shift towards changing those oppressive and disabling barriers in workplaces. So first of all, we need to name them, and then we need to move towards changing them. We mustn't stigmatize disability or neurodiversity, but equally, it's not a superpower either. And the number of times people have said to me, oh, I really want to employ an autistic person because they're superheroes, or they can do anything I want them to do. That's discriminatory in itself. It's stereotypes. But equally, I've had someone say to me, wouldn't it just be easier if you stopped calling people disabled? And the thing is, if we don't name what we see, we don't change it. If we don't acknowledge it, we can't change it. So if we center the social model of disability and the voices of disabled people working in research, we can develop, co-design with them strategies towards changing the workplace to be more inclusive. And that's me finished. Thank you very much. I'm almost out of breath, but thank you very much.
Kate, thank you so much. Thank you very much for that presentation. I'm now going to hand over to Amit.
Hello, so let me just share my screen. So I'm afraid some of my slides are the same as Kate's. So I'm going to, I will just go through those quickly. I'm not Dolly. So I've lost my thing now. Can you see my slides okay? Is that okay? Cool. Okay, so I want to introduce the National Association of Disabled Staff Networks to you. So I'm very lucky to be the chair, as Jen very kindly said at the beginning. So we are a super network with a mission to connect and represent disabled staff networks. We are focused on the tertiary education sector, so universities and colleges, and other organizations in the public sectors, like NHS Trust. We're welcoming to any individual and organization from any sector committed to promoting the equity, diversity, inclusion, and access of disabled staff. We act as a collective platform to share experiences and good practice and to examine those challenges and opportunities we all face together as disabled people. We are a non-governmental, thank God, independent, self-determining and dynamic community led by and made up of impassioned disabled people. And we started up 9 years ago. Next year will be our 10th birthday. We're going to do some celebrations next year. So some of our aims are to promote disability equality and campaign for disabled staff networks to be supported in the workplace, to promote the interests of disabled staff on a national level, to challenge those stereotypes that Kate was talking about by endorsing the social model of disability, promoting a positive image of disabled people, and eliminating that deficit and medical model that presents us as the problem. To organize and deliver accessible events that can bring disabled staff and disability equality allies together, create regional hubs to make it easier for members to meet each other, support relevant research projects, policies, guidance for disabled staff, managers and institutions of tertiary education and others, and government agencies too. And importantly, to link with disabled students. As Kate said, there's those two constituencies at universities. So particularly at the postgraduate doctoral levels, to make those connections there and provide some kind of support and mentoring for future disabled staff, if you like. So I've got this slide on the social model of disability. So let me just go through it, go through this quickly. The social model of disability identifies systemic barriers, negative attitudes and exclusion by society, purposefully or inadvertently. That means society is the main contributory factor in disabling us. This includes prejudice, ignorance, stigma, negative attitudes, inaccessible places, transport, conversations, and information. And this kind of event that's held online kind of breaks down some of those barriers in terms of inaccessible places, for example, and disabled people being included in these conferences. Information being made accessible, for example, to learning disabled people in different formats is something that should be done. And there are, of course, newer models as well of disability kind of evolving all the time to include chronic illness and neurodiversity better. So there are, I think the affirmative model of disability, for example, is one such of those kind of evolutionary steps in our understanding, in our understanding of what disability means to us. The Scope website has a brilliant video on there of what the social model of disability means to us as disabled people. Well worth a watch. So this is backed up by the Convention on the Rights of Persons with Disabilities from the United Nations. So that puts this whole topic of disability in the perspective of human rights, that it is our right to be part of society. And every year, the United Nations has designated the 3rd of December as the International Day of, as we like to put it, disabled people, as they like to put it, persons with disabilities. But yeah, it's a great celebration of our place in the world. And of course, as Kate said as well before, that there can be, and the title of this whole plenary is, that there can be nothing about us without us. We have to be front and center in anything to do with anything. Everything affects disabled people in many ways, and we need to be part of every conversation going on. So yes, nothing about us without us. Oh my gosh, I've got the ideal academic as well. So again, just reinforcing what Kate said about those stereotypes of about what makes an ideal academic. And Kate published this back in 2017. I think that might have been when we first met, actually, Kate, a long time ago. and we were bowled over by Kate's work, and we're really, really proud to go on and work with her on this project on disability inclusive science careers that Kate and her team led, reimagining academia from the disabled researcher's point of view. But also some of our colleagues in NADSEN published papers around accessibility in STEM, the barriers that we face, and recommendations for how to remove those barriers and make disabled scientists more included. But also colleagues published some books around ableism in academia, kind of theorizing and contextualizing the experiences of disabled people in the sector. And this more recent book on disability in higher education. So both of those are kind of giving, highlight the experiences, the lived experiences of disabled people in academia, and also present recommendations again for how those should be addressed. We've put together a problem statement around how disabled people are excluded in STEM particularly, and have kind of themated that and put together a paper that then we've gone on to the, I don't know how much time I'm left, so maybe 2 minutes. We've gone with this problem statement to major funders in the sector to say, look, these are our lived experiences of what we're kind of the challenges we face and the barriers we face in STEM, in academia, and we need your support to break these down. So we're hoping that the Royal Society and others, and working with Kate's EDI caucus as well, that we can work together and be commissioned to look at a big recommendations project that will hopefully make disabled people more included in STEM and wider, in the wider sector as well. So there's already some great work going on out there by all sorts of organizations. And we've just become involved in a project that's kicked off this month, funded by the Wellcome Trust and hosted by the University of Sheffield. Professor Dan Goodley is the PI on this project that's beautifully entitled Disability Matters, Making Disability the Driving Subject of Inquiry instead of an afterthought in many of the much research that's done out there. So NADSEN is very excited to have a major role on this project with Dan and others. So some of the research questions, if I just have a minute just to go through these, some of the research questions that this project will deal with, which is a six-year project and is an international collaboration with disabled researchers and disabled people's organizations in other countries as well, which makes it even more amazing. So number one, how is health research, theory and scholarship transformed by an engagement with critical disability studies, which is Dan's area of expertise? What are the health priorities of disabled people in Australia, Canada, India, Singapore, and the United Kingdom? So those are the countries involved in this particular project. What kinds of research methodologies represent disabled people and their health priorities? How does the presence of disability enable more inclusive health research environments? In what ways can we reimagine representations of disability in health research? And how do we build a new generation of disabled and disability positive health researchers? The last question is one that hopefully will make a huge impact for us. What transformative knowledge pertaining to equity, diversity, and inclusion can be generated through a focus on anti-ableist and anti-disablist practice? And this, we hope, from NADSEN's point of view, could lead on to a framework around disability equality in the higher education sector, which right now does not exist, really. So we're very excited by that. I'm just going to end on this slide showing famous, very famous, amazing physicist, Professor Stephen Hawking, as he was on this episode of Star Trek. I love Star Trek. The Next Generation sat alongside Isaac Newton and Einstein, and they very ably assisted by Commander Data there playing a game of poker. And this is what I want to see happen in the future, that disabled scientists sit alongside and are included and play a level role with everybody else. I hope that makes sense. Perhaps. Thank you so much.
Hamid, thank you. My goodness, some amazing research questions there. And not a Star Trek fan, but by osmosis, I've seen a lot of it. So thank you for sharing that. We're bang on time, Rachel. Thank you very much. I'm going to now invite you to do your presentation.
Lovely, thank you. I shall share my screen. Hopefully get back to the start, giving all my tricks away before we even begin. So hello everyone, thanks very much for coming along today. My name is Rachel van Crimpen. I work at the University of Nottingham. I've got about 10 years experience of working in the postgraduate research space specifically, and the last 8.5 of those has been as a doctoral training partnership manager for a BBSRC DTP. And since December, I've also been spending about 80% of my time as director of EDI and people for our Faculty of Science, but very much still with an absolute soft spot for postgraduate research. So I'm going to focus in a little bit on the PGR space and talk a little bit about a project in that space through the disability lens, and talk a little bit about some specific actions that we've taken within my DTP and more broadly at Nottingham as a result of that, which have had a positive impact in terms of supporting our disabled PGRs. So I've kind of said what I'm going to cover there. So yeah, the project is called Postgraduate Researchers from Diverse Backgrounds, a framework for defining, measuring and supporting success. So it did look quite broadly at diverse backgrounds of different students. But of the 150 people who completed our survey, around a third of those did identify as disabled. So I'm going to kind of focus in a little bit on those responses and what that told us in a moment. So it was a collaborative enhancement project. It was funded by QAA, the Quality and Assurance Agency, and it was led by Nottingham in partnership with Leeds, Warwick, the Scottish Graduate School of Social Sciences, which covers the whole of Scotland. And it was very much linked to the National Education Opportunities Network, which has a working group focusing on postgraduate widening participation. And I lead the on-course success work stream of that group. And this project came out of that work stream where we were really thinking, okay, if we are going to do all of this work in the recruitment space for postgraduate research, we're trying to diversify the cohorts of students that we're recruiting, then we also need to be thinking about whether the support mechanisms we have in place for those students are appropriate for a more diverse cohort and whether we need to be changing what we do in order to support people more effectively. And just to note that the whole project was co-designed with and then co-delivered by PGRs. So we had various PGRs employed with us over the course of a year to carry out design and carry out this research and help put together the recommendations. So in very kind of top level summary, some of the things that came out from the disabled participants in this project were that they were more likely to feel they didn't belong within their university as researchers, more likely to experience imposter phenomenon than other students. They were more likely to consider that their induction was poor. They were very likely to tell us that the support available to them felt like it was focused for undergraduates rather than for postgraduates, and that the people giving that support didn't necessarily get where they were coming from or what their specific needs were. They felt that support was available in practice, but not necessarily in reality. And a particular theme that came out was that there was a lack of support and understanding of neurodivergence in the support that they received. So there's a couple of quotes there from focus group participants. So one pointing out around the fact that the accommodations that were suggested to them by their disability support service were very undergraduate in tone and very much focused around software. And another pointing out that while they do need to work differently to other people, there was some pressure there that made them feel like they had to work like everybody else. So what we did with all of the outcomes of this work, and this is readily available on our website, and I can pop a link in the chat later if people are interested, is we kind of looked at it from a theory of change perspective, with the ultimate goal being better support for PGLs from diverse backgrounds across the board. And when we broke it down into kind of overarching goals and then into much smaller things that you could do. And there's a whole other section that you can imagine off to the left-hand side of this slide with much more specific actions on it, which are then delved into within the guide. And I'm going to just dig into some of these recommendations now and give some examples of the things that we've done practically and how they've worked out at Nottingham, in case they're of interest to people. So in the area of postgraduate researcher specific support, which really was the thing that came out really loud and clear from this. One of the things within the doctoral training partnership that I manage that we've been able to do is recruit two fantastic specialist postgraduate researcher welfare and EDI officers, one of whom has a specific speciality in disability support. They work with our students on the DTP, and they offer one-to-one support and advice for postgraduate researchers. And they also often offer one-to-one support and advice for supervisors. So it's not at all unusual for them to be supporting both the PGR and the supervisor to come together and come up with a solution to an issue that comes up. And it's very common, actually, that particularly in cases where there might be neurodivergence, particularly recently diagnosed neurodivergence, where someone's maybe figuring it out for themselves, that those officers work with both the supervisor and the student to come up with what the right way forward for them as a working partnership is going to look like. They also offer PGR-focused training for support services. So, for example, they've done specific PGR-focused training with our support and wellbeing officers at the university. They've also offered training for the disability support services as well. And something that we've just started doing quite recently, which seems really obvious when you think about it, is that we've been starting to take a really proactive approach to reasonable adjustments, because the students that we work with, our PGRs, they know them very well. They have kind of into one-to-one relationships across the whole cohort. There's about 240 students. So now when we have big events coming up, rather than just sending out an email saying, if you need any reasonable adjustments, let us know and we'll be happy to accommodate them, they're aware of where people might have specific needs, and they've been making a point of approaching people directly to ask them if specific adjustments might be of use. So an example of this in practice was our annual conference last year, which is quite a big event, and they were aware of some students who were likely to find that quite a daunting experience, and they got in touch and offered the opportunity to go for a walk around, the opportunity to present in smaller rooms, and several of those students did take up those offers, and were very grateful for it. Those who didn't take up the offer were incredibly pleased to be asked, and they gave us the feedback that just the fact that these specific suggestions have been made was really meaningful and useful to them and made them feel valued. In induction, we have the capacity, which I think is very lucky within the DTP, to be able to offer one-to-one pre-arrival welcome calls for all of our incoming postgraduate researchers. And so before they arrive, at least a month before they, so around this time, our PGRs are all having a one-to-one call with one of our wellbeing and EDI officers. So this can cover anything from someone's nervous about where to park on induction day to identifying where people are going to need ongoing, more specific support. They're going to need to get their DSA put in. They're going to need adjustments in place. And it means that we can make sure things are ready to go for them during our induction period when they arrive already, and that they've already got that existing relationship with our welfare and EDI officers ready to continue that throughout the course of their PhD. And we often find that people kind of cling to the officer that they met during their induction calls, and that will be the person they go to on repeat throughout the whole of their PhD in terms of getting their support and signposting. Throughout the induction period and kind of the first term, really, and this is within the whole researcher academy that we're based in rather than just the DTP, we offer wellbeing focused drop-in sessions with coffee and cake available, so a bit of networking. We often attach them to a training session as well, so that there's kind of a reason to be there beyond just coming for the drop-in session. And these tend not to have massive crowds, but the those who do come find them incredibly valuable, and that having the opportunity to access PGR specific support at those has been highlighted as something incredibly valuable. And we've also just been working on ensuring that our supervisors have the same information as the PGRs so that they can also support in the signposting as well. And then in terms of awareness, we've done quite a lot of training, which has been PGR focused around wellbeing support. So recently, there's been a spotlight on supervising disabled PGRs, which was a collaboration between our welfare and EDI officers and our disability support office. Got really strong feedback from the supervisors who participated in it. It was a really great forum for discussion. And we've also got some specific resources available around supervising postgraduate researchers from diverse backgrounds, and there's several pages of that guide which are focused on disability and the different ways of approaching supporting students with different sorts of disabilities and the resources and support available. And we're also running a lot of training and awareness sessions and also reflection sessions around neurodiversity. And the reflection sessions follow on from the awareness sessions and are a chance for people to come together and discuss what they're actually going to do as a result of their increased awareness, and kind of put practical actions in place. So that's something that we're doing in the Faculty of Science specifically at the moment. And you can see at the bottom here as well, that tiny little text, I'm afraid. We also run a mental health awareness for supervisors training, which again is a PGR specific version of some mental health awareness training to really explore what mental health support looks like for supervisors and where the boundaries of that relationship might sit and the key information they might need in order to support PGRs effectively in that space. So it's just a little bit of practice for you to end this session on. Thank you very much. I'll stop.
Yes, Rachel, thank you so much. And wait till Rachel's slides come down. And fantastic, thank you. So thank you very much to all our speakers. We did say that there would be provocation, and there are certainly plenty in there and some really interesting themes that are running through. We've got just about 20 minutes. I've got questions in the Q&A. I can see I've got some hands raised as well. So what I'm proposing that we do is that I will pick up one of the questions that's been in the Q&A quite a long time, and then I will come to hands raised, and then we will go back into the questions in the Q&A, and I will hope we will kind of manage this well. So, and I'm also going to ask the panelists if you can be kind of quite brief and succinct in terms of your kind of responses. Thank you very much. So we're going to start with the first question. What practical actions would you like us, researcher developments, who work with research staff, to take? So anyone who would like to begin, Kate, it started from your presentation. So just one or two practical actions that you would like researcher developers to take or to consider.
I think really it kind of takes on from both Hamid's and Rachel's presentations about, if you use a social model of disability, you can look at the barriers that people are facing. So to speak to disabled people, identify the barriers they're experiencing, and then work with relevant organisations to overcome those barriers. So for example, it can be things like, do you have hybrid meetings? You know, it can be practical things like that. It can be making sure you always have British Sign Language interpreting available, you always have accurate captioning available. I think it's also about working with people to embed disability into their research proposals as well. So if somebody's going for a future leadership fellowship application, for example, then how have they built disability inclusion into that? The funders want to see that. So how have they gone around doing that? So I think it's, for me, it's really all rooted in a very practical approach, identifying barriers and then finding ways to overcome them. Because what we're talking about here is actually just good management. You don't need to do special things for disabled people. If you're a good manager, you will be doing all of the right things.
You're getting lots of nod from your other panelists. Hamid or Rachel, anything you would like to add to that response?
I suppose just to say, yeah, all of the things I've just talked about, while a lot of them have specifically benefited our disabled PGRs, I think they've benefited everybody in the programme. So I suppose our approach has been to start by identifying some specific steps, start doing them, embed them, build on it, do more, and make it a habit that you're thinking about those things as part of your planning. So if it feels overwhelming because there's so many different things you should do, do one thing and then build it up from there, because and then it becomes part of what you're doing as standard, and it's just how you operate from there on in. So just don't feel like you have to swallow the whole frog every time.
Wonderful, thank you. And Hamid, if I could put you a little bit on the spot, we've got a related question in terms of neurodiversity as a disability and what research and developers should be aware of so that they can provide inclusive training, equity of access to career development and support. So I know neurodiversity ran through all of the presentations. Any specific thoughts on neurodiversity before we go to the hands up?
So again, I think just like Kate and Rachel have said, it's about having that conversation with people about flexibility, about what kind of approaches work for people. Sometimes, people who are neurodivergent maybe don't absorb things in the same way, that are kind of usual, or this, what am I trying to say? I don't think I can answer this question very well. What about the other panelists? What do you guys think?
I think you're doing a great job, Hemi, but anybody else want to come in just specifically on that neurodiversity piece?
So my experience is, so we've done a lot of work around neurodiversity as well, and we do a lot of training with senior leaders in universities about disability inclusion, neurodiversity. The door is already partly open on neurodiversity. It's a much easier thing to get access to senior people on than disability per se. That's not necessarily a positive thing, because quite often it's associated with a male view. So the sort of Simon Baron Cohen's extreme male brain thesis, and there's a business case. So the business case is we want neurodivergent people because they're really good at analysing data, and they'll just sit in their office and get all of their work done. And that's the kind of thing that we hear. And actually, no two people are the same. And neurodivergent women often don't present in the same kind of way as neurodivergent men. So it's certainly being discussed, but it's being discussed, like I said at my slides, as a superpower rather than the actual lived experience.
Thank you. Thank you very much for that. I see one of the hands raised has gone down. If that person wants to pop it back up again, please do so. But if not, I'm going to go over to Guillermo, who I think has a question. I hope I pronounced that properly. I'm not sure if we're able to. And are we able to hear someone? Oh, here we go. Yes, I can see you on screen. You're on mute. Well done. Thank you.
No, sorry. It was raised by mistake.
Oh, okay. No, that's absolutely no problem at all. No, thank you. Well, we know you're there. Thank you for being here. So I'm going to go back to the Q&A. Still disappointing to see how far we have to go in creating equity for all. And a question about whether chronic conditions, things like ME, chronic fatigue syndrome, are being represented within the data and the groups. So are people including, or do they have data or particular insights for those kind of chronic conditions? Anyone like to come in on that?
I mean, certainly our data does, and people with a condition that's lasted 12 months or more and has significant effect on their disabilities are covered by disability. Those are some of the most common conditions we see. And I also want to say as well that long COVID and chronic fatigue syndrome are very similar conditions. So we're actually going to see a lot more disabled people in work in general, particularly in universities. So yes, that's very much a common theme, and it's something is represented. One of the comments I always got in any of the interviews I did is we're all knackered, but some of us are more knackered than others in reference to academics. And fatigue is the kind of common thread across all the data collection I've ever done. Obviously, that can quite often go along with mental health conditions as well because of the challenges of navigating work and life. So yes, it's very much represented. And what is needed there, I think, is flexibility. What we found, though, is most people are forced to go part-time or to give up work altogether because of the attitude of universities. So I've seen interviewed a researcher who disclosed she had chronic fatigue syndrome. So she just lost her job. That was it. The employer said, well, in that case, you probably can't do your job. And that was the end of it. And most people don't know they can appeal that. Most people don't have a union rep to go in and kind of push that. So it very much is a common thread. And yes, we certainly included, you know, long-term health conditions.
Anybody else want to come in on the kind of, as you say, the kind of the fatigue element, which may go, be ongoing? Rachel, did you want to come in?
Yeah, I was just going to say, yes, those groups were included in our project as well, and though we haven't pulled them out specifically because numbers, it wasn't a huge project, so numbers would be too small to kind of pull anything specific out, but they were included and represented. And I would say again that fatigue is definitely something that came up a lot there too, so I just echo what Kate said.
And it's interesting to hear again, it's that kind of management model that we're talking about in terms of what happens in practice, or apparent management model. Hemi, do you have anything particularly you wanted to add before we move on?
At Manchester University, where we've been working on trying to identify rest spaces for people, particularly with fatigue issues during the day, so somebody can just go and have a lie down for a bit, and therefore be able to then, you know, carry on working and keep their job and do what they want to do. So it's those kind of adjustments that people need in those circumstances. And you know, we have at Manchester University and others have like breastfeeding facilities, for example. So we're trying to provide these kind of rest facilities as well, not kind of combining everything into the same room with first aid and stuff, because that goes back to the medical model again. That's horrible. Thank you.
That's a really, really interesting point. Thank you for that. Just that literally framing the space for people. I'd like to move on. We've got a question about supporting PGR specifically and their experience. Your experience of teaching colleagues, whether the experience as teaching colleagues has been discussed and what feedback and support might have been focused in this area. So we're thinking of people who have teaching roles as well as a kind of, you know, research roles. Is there any particular insight or data that anybody can offer us on that?
As I've spoken about PGR, I have to say it's not something that came out specifically from this work, and it's not something that I've got data on. I've got some discussions and things that I've had with PGRs over the last decade around this, and I think often it's seen that access to those opportunities is not equal, and that it's often done on top of an already full-time workload. So when there are issues in place such as fatigue, etc., or you might need to work a reduced week, then it becomes more difficult to access those opportunities as well. So I've certainly had lots of conversations around that, but I can't offer any specific data. Maybe one of my colleagues has something more concrete to offer.
Anybody else want to come in on that one? And I should keep us moving. We've got lots of questions. One which is identified as just a comment, but I think it's an important one in terms of it's about allyship. And, you know, seeing jobs that are advertised, we've recognised disabled staff are underrepresented at high levels in our university. How can non-disabled staff be better allies to disabled staff? And I think, Hamid, you spoke about kind of allyship, didn't you, in terms of the networks. But anybody got any perspectives on, you know, how allyship can be really effective?
So allyship, I think, is about people who don't identify as being disabled coming in and joining the fight, if you like, and understanding what those issues are, being part of the conversations. Although there are some disabled people who say that we should be, you know, doing that for ourselves and not having to be relying on allies. But allies, I think, are important because they're the one, you know, non-disabled people are the ones who take up at those leadership positions right now. We are so underrepresented in those influential places. So we need those allies, and we need to be welcoming to them and talking to them and telling them, sharing our stories with them so they understand our perspective and can offer their support, whether that's mentoring or, you know, getting somebody up the ladder somehow. Those kind of things, I think, are important in terms of an ally. And as well, you know, we can be allies, you know, for me, for example, I can be an ally to my colleagues in the LGBT community, for example. So allyship is so important to keep our communities together as well. And it also speaks to intersectionality. None of us live, excuse me, none of us live with just a single identity. We have so much as people. So, I hope that makes sense.
Thank you. It really does. And for if I could invite Rachel and Kate to come in and just adding to one of the comments that's come in about, you know, this is not an issue for disabled people to fix. And so, you know, thinking about kind of, you know, how can others help in the context of saying, you know, nothing about us without us. And, you know, it's not just for disabled people to address the societal issues. Kate, did you want to come in? Oh, no. Rachel, any thoughts on allyship?
So I hope that I'm an ally to my disabled colleagues. And I'm not disabled myself. I think it's when you take on EDI leadership roles, it can be a difficult space to inhabit, because you do get people who very much think that it's not your space. And I mean, in any protected characteristic, if you don't have that characteristic, you're not part of this, you don't understand, this is for us. And then there's the other side of the coin, whereby the emotional labor, the effort, the energy shouldn't have to come from those who are the ones who are underrepresented. And it is a difficult space to navigate. And I'm sure that I don't get it right. Lots of people don't get it right all the time. And you won't get it right for everybody any of the time, as far as I can tell. So my approach to it is to listen as best as I can, to give space for people to share their views, to take those on board, to recognize that people's experiences are valid. And even if I don't understand them or recognize them myself, to give space to those experiences and ensure that they inform what I'm doing, to check in and check back and give feedback on the direction we're going in and check that it is the right direction, and keep people part of the conversation as much as they want to be as well. Because sometimes people want to get really involved and they want to lead it, and they want you to just step back and maybe use your role to support them in that. And other times they want to give you some feedback and they want you to do something about it. And it's just navigating all of that. It's not straightforward, but it's important to try and do it and accept that sometimes you'll get it wrong, and then listen to the feedback when you do and grow from that and get comfortable with being uncomfortable, I suppose, is the general headspace you have to be in as soon as you step into working in the EDI space, I think.
Thank you very much for that. And I think, you know, both of those responses really just talk to, you know, the points about saying it's really about being part of it and being in it and being with people and alongside people. We've got some really good comments, which I'm hoping we might get back to, but there is a particular question that I wanted to go to, but points about terminology, neurodiversity relating to diversity within the population. As an autistic person, I find this seems a nuisance or a subject of fascination. Neither sees me as a human being. Thank you for sharing that comment. Also had any comments in relation to marginal identities that overlap with disability. You know, so disability is so often a secondary thought in EDI, absolutely. One of the questions that I wanted to put to the panel, because I suspect it is front of mind and it will need to be our kind of our final question, although I'm going to put a cheeky one in there if I can, if I have time, is one of the key problems that particular institution that this person is from is the support from disability services, the waiting list being approximately 4 months. How do you suggest we push forward to the university that it's not acceptable? So how do we get this up the agenda and make it, you know, the support real and available and timely for people?
Gosh, yeah, that's a really difficult.
That is
a long waiting list. That's 4 months. In if you're doing a PhD, that's a huge chunk of time that you needed support. And if it's just to the first appointment, you're not even going to have it in place from 4 months. So it's a huge chunk of time, and it's not going to set you off on the best start at all. So I suppose if I was trying to address that here, I would probably be doing my best to put the case to my colleagues in senior spaces. So we've got a Pro Vice Chancellor for Equality, Diversity, Inclusion and People here who is a very open person who we would be able to approach. So I would be trying to advocate at the highest level. I feel able to do that. Whatever the hierarchy is and wherever you can take it, I think it would be worth pursuing it. And I suppose putting together the case that articulates why that is such a massive issue for our researchers. It doesn't mean it's easy to do that. So, for example, in my DTP, I've spoken about the welfare and EDI officers that we have that are specific PGR resource. That wasn't in place when I took in this role. And that came about as a result of making the case for it over a considerable period of time after single-handedly doing it. And now it's two people doing that work. So it can be hard work. But I think if you're sufficiently relentless about these things, sometimes they eventually get somewhere. It's my personal take. I'm a little bit of an energizer bunny when it comes to these things. So,
Hamid or Kate, any other thoughts? Thank you, Rachel. Any other thoughts on how we get this up the agenda where we find institutions are kind of slow to respond?
So I think at Manchester, our support for disabled students is pretty good. I don't think people are waiting 4 months. But on the staff side, things are very different. So we very fortunately have a disability support service for staff specifically, and that sits alongside the support for students, for disabled students. But it's really under resourced, really underfunded. There's only one person to handle thousands of cases at this university, it seems like all of the priority, when you compare students to staff, the priority seems to always be students, and it just seems very kind of strange and unfair as well that there's not more emphasis given to support disabled staff in terms of the resourcing of the support services needed, and they really are needed. Like Rachel said, you know, if you've not got the support in place for a PhD student for 4 months, that's a huge chunk of time out of that study period. Likewise, if you're a research staff on a fixed term contract, you know, even a month is a long time not to have the support you need to be able to do your job. And that has implications going forwards, of course. So it's just as big a need and requirement as it is for students, for staff to be well supported too.
Thank you.
Hope that makes some sense.
Thank you. Thank you very much. We're right at the end of our time. Okay, was there anything in particular you wanted to add to that? We're right at the end of time and I need to hand over to my colleague, but is there anything in particular you wanted to add?
I think it's just to say that universities need to be forced to change, and whether that force is going to come from Research England, whether it's going to come from the Scottish Funding Council, I think it's probably going to take a massive legal suit. And NatWest had a multi-million pound legal suit taken out against it for discriminating against a disabled person. I think it's going to be something like that. Money talks, essentially.
Well, thank you so much to our panellists. What a really interesting, provoking afternoon. I hope we invited you to use the plenary to consider what you can do and what you will do to challenge ableism. And I hope that that's something that you will take away today. I'm going to hand over now to my colleague.
Thank you, Jan. Yeah, Robin Mellors born here, research director of Kraken Vitae, and privileged to have done at least a little work in this space, considering career progression for disabled researchers. Just a couple of closing comments because we're at the end of time. One, I think, is that I hope you've been provoked. And my recommendation, if you take anything away from this, is to take a copy of Kate Sahamid's slide on the ideal academic, shove it on your wall, and then think about the implications for your practice. I think it's worth bearing in mind that many researchers who could declare that they are disabled don't choose to do so. So if everything is left for them to request, then that will really restrict progress. And therefore, taking a much more, if you like, overt approach to this, I think could have benefits. So really talking about and raising the questions of what could be possible and sharing stories of what has been possible. So we don't put all the onus on disabled scientists and disabled researchers to have to ask. I'm sure there's a lot we could learn from other sectors who may or may not have been subject to legal challenges. And interesting indeed that funders are actually ahead of the game on this. Anyway, what I'd like to do in summing up is say thank you so much for the session. Thank you, Kate, Hamid and Rachel, for your provocations, for your insights into what's been done practically, and really challenge all of us to think about what could we do. Thank you very much. We will see you again tomorrow. And also draw attention, there is actually a special interest session C3 tomorrow morning by Catherine Dean, which is looking at sort of access issues within research. But anyway, I think it's time to go out and get some of that warm sunshine outside. Thank you very much for your attention.